an economy where there are 100 people and 100 different needs, this is probably not a very efficient system. And so we came up with the idea of money. Money could do three things that the barter system couldn't. One, you could use it as a unit of measurement. So I could measure the price of your fish in money. Two, you could use it as a medium of exchange. So I could pay you a certain amount for a good or service that you produce. And three, you could store your value. So you didn't have to spend all your money today. Instead, you could put it in institutions that you trusted, known as banks, which could hold your money for a certain amount of time. And if tomorrow you needed it for something, say for example, an expensive college tuition, you could withdraw this money and then spend it. But what happened in 2008? In 2008, the world saw the worst recession since 1929. It's because these very institutions that we trusted, these banks, made loans to people who couldn't pay them back. And so overnight, we lost hundreds and millions of dollars. People like us, common people. Simultaneously, in 2008 in Japan, this individual called Satoshi Nakamoto, who nobody knows who he is till today, came up with the idea of Bitcoin. So the idea was very simple, as Sanjayji explained. If I have to transfer you money, why do I need a bank to verify that transaction? Bitcoin started what is known as peer-to-peer transactions without the need for an intermediary. However, over a period of time, Bitcoin came to be used for wrong purposes. You hear a lot about it being used to buy drugs on the dark web. And of course, it's very volatile. I mean, today the Bitcoin is worth 1,000, but tomorrow it could be worth $20,000. But the idea behind the Bitcoin, the blockchain, is really what is a powerful idea. So the blockchain essentially uses the power of the pen. It says basically, if A has a pen, and A wants to transfer the power of the pen to B, the ownership of the pen, and if C, D, and E agree on two things. One, that yes, A was the owner of this pen, and two, that A did transfer the pen to B, then there is no need for a bank to come in the middle of this transaction. So it's using the power of the plenty, like what Wikipedia does. It's crowdsourcing. There are, however, other very powerful aspects of the blockchain. The second is that unlike the centralized banking system, the blockchain works on a distributed ledger. What that essentially means is that tomorrow, if you have a Punjab National Bank go down, you're not going to be affected because the blockchain is distributed. It exists on the cloud, and different people in different parts of the world have access to this ledger. The second most powerful thing about the blockchain is that it's open source. So unlike the traditional banking system or other institutions which hide behind opaque personnel, opaque papers, opaque way of doing things, anyone can access the blockchain. So it is literally an open door that you can go and see how things are functioning. And finally, the third most powerful thing about the blockchain is that you literally have to imagine it as a chain. So each transaction is essentially a link, and each transaction is linked to the one before. So if I have to manipulate the one in between, and I have to make that a lie, I'll have to manipulate everyone before that till the very first transaction in the history of blockchain. So it's super difficult, if not completely impossible, to manipulate the blockchain. So it's rather a secure ecosystem. So now cities like Dubai are actually already using the blockchain in things like smart contracts. What that means is that you no longer have to have lawyers going in court and fighting about whether the terms of the contract have been fulfilled. You codify the contract, you put it on a blockchain, and when the parties meet their promises, automatically whoever is supposed to get whatever gets it. So there's no, it auto-executes itself essentially. For people like you and I, the blockchain can do three things. One, you can have your identity on the blockchain. Two, you can prove ownership over something over the blockchain. And three, you can conduct transactions on the blockchain in a secure, paperless, and a digital manner. Imagine the thousands and millions of refugees who move across the world every year. For them, the blockchain is a great thing. Yesterday, I went to a doctor in Gwalior and I realized I forgot my medical records in Delhi. If this was a blockchain-based health system, I didn't need to carry my medical records anymore. If I was in Patna or Panipat or Paris, it doesn't matter. I can have access to my medical documents and I can decide who I want to give access to these documents. Land. I watched Khosla ka Khosla, and the problem of Benami land in India is such a big deal. So what the blockchain can do is that you can prove that you have ownership over a land by digitizing all your land titles. If you have to transfer ownership, you do that with a blockchain as well. And so you can't have a third party saying, nahi ye land mera hai, because all of that is essentially very important. This is Imogen Heap. What happens every time you download track from Pirate Bay, you're essentially devoiding these people of their money. So artists are now putting their music on the blockchain, and every time you listen to their music, a part of money gets transferred to them. So people who are creating content are now being rewarded for the content that they are creating. remove all these intermediaries, which is a big deal for the banking system. What you can also do is reduce the fraud because it's a rather secure system. Voting. Countries like Estonia are already doing a lot on voting through the blockchain. So imagine a country like India where you have 1.25 billion people who stand for hours and hours in queue, being able to do it through a digital and a secure system. What will that do to our voter base? And finally, if you look at the blockchain, let me ask you, how many of you know how much of your data these companies have access to? Or the second question, how many of you are getting paid for all of this data that you're giving to Facebook, LinkedIn, to Twitter and Instagram, that they are in turn selling it to advertisers? Imagine a blockchain where you have access to all your data, you decide what data you want to share with who, and if you share that data, you actually get paid for it. I especially feel in a country like India, where you have your basic requirements of roti, kapda, paisa and makan, if all of that is put on a blockchain, it will